Cora.
Okay, thank you very much for this very kind introduction. I guess I didn't understand it. So, no, fine, it's fine. Okay, so, and of course, I would like to thank the organizers for the invitation to be part of this meeting here and also for the possibility to visit Thessaloniki, which is really a very wonderful and beautiful and also very interesting city. And today in the morning, so my first view out of the window was to see the Olymp, or the residence of the ancient gods. So it's really great here, I would say. Okay, now what I will do in the next 25 minutes is to talk about type 2 diabetes and exercise. And as you can see, I chose a quite provocative title, so Running for a Future Without Diabetes. And I guess we all will agree upon that this is quite unlikely that there will be a future without diabetes. But what diabetes can do is to delay the onset of type 2 diabetes. And first of all, I will explain that in quite easy words. And that is that at least at one century, we all can see this strong increase in our lifespan. And as kind of a side effect of this increase in lifespan, we have a longer period of chronic degenerative diseases. And the cause for that is that with aging, we have a decline in overall functionality. So we have a decline in motor function, vascular function, we have metabolic dysfunctions, and we have a cognitive decline. And this then, again, is the cause for the onset of, for example, type 2 diabetes or the other chronic degenerative diseases. And the onset of one of these diseases then again has a negative impact on our overall functionality. So we have here, as we can say, kind of a vicious cycle. And what exercise can do here is to maintain our functionality. So to delay with that the onset of this chronic degenerative diseases. And so it's very important to not only extend lifespan, it's very important to extend the health span. And here exercise, I would say, is quite important. However, this knowledge is not really new. Almost 2,500 years ago, Hippocrates already said, if you could give every individual the right amount of food and exercise, not too little and not too much, then we would have found the safest way to health. And I think this is quite remarkable. He already was talking only about health and not lifespan. And he already knew about the importance of food and exercise. And very remarkable, I would say, have a look on this wording. If we could give, so this active wording, in a way as if humans themselves are not able to make a good and wise decision how to live. Nowadays we don't have any Greek philosophers anymore that tell us how we should live. Today we have the WHO, which gives us guidelines of physical activity. And you can see here per day, these are 20 to 30 minutes walking the dog or gardening, or 10 to 15 minutes per day of a more heavy exercise. So for example, cycling up a hill or football, playing basketball, tennis, and so on. And this does not look very much. However, only 35% of all adults in the EU can be classified as indeed sufficiently active. And so physical inactivity is a global phenomenon and is a leading risk factor for the development of chronic degenerative diseases. And in one of her landmarking studies, Bente Pedersen could demonstrate the deleterious effects of physical inactivity. And in the study, young healthy males, they are lean and they also have a very good physical activity and cardiorespiratory fitness. They just reduced their daily steps from 10,000 to 1,500 over 2 weeks. And look what happened. Of course, they have a decrease in their overall energy expenditure by 40%. They have a decline in their cardiovascular fitness during these 2 weeks by 7%. And they have a reduction in their glucose tolerance by 17% after only 2 weeks of reducing their daily food steps. And what did happen else? So they have, interestingly, a reduction in their body mass, and this can be explained by a reduction in their lean mass, so most likely a reduction in their muscle mass. And this goes along with an increase in visceral fat. And you all know about the importance of visceral fat in the context of insulin sensitivity or development of insulin resistance. So physical inactivity is quite deleterious. And in contrary, of course, exercise is very important to prevent type 2 diabetes. And now I will come to more details. This was now theory, now I will come to the real world. So of course it's very important to increase the number of physically active people. And I think it's also very important to understand the mechanisms of the exercise response and which kind of adaptations are necessary to improve insulin sensitivity and glucose control. So to understand and know the positive regulators in this response, which what must happen to improve. And then of course, are there negative regulators that can reduce the benefit from exercise? And then there's always the discussion whether type 2 diabetes itself is a risk factor for a reduced response to exercise, so reduced improvement. And we in Tübingen, we are very interested in identifying such positive regulators. And we are doing so by exercise intervention studies, and Anja Böhm is very important here for the clinical part. And what she did is she recruited participants that are untrained, that do not have type 2 diabetes, but that have a high risk for developing type 2 diabetes. And this is in most cases in BMI above 27. And then these participants were trained 8 weeks, 3 times a week. And this 3 times a week, then 30 minutes on a bike and 30 minutes on a treadmill, walking on a treadmill, at 80% of their individual VO2 max. And you can see we did a lot of phenotyping, and we also took tissue biopsies, so muscle biopsies and adipose tissue biopsies for molecular fingerprinting and also for investigating the molecular mechanisms. And now I will show you typical outcome of the studies. First of all participants are able to improve their physical fitness. They can improve their individual anaerobic threshold. Not all, but many participants can improve their cardiorespiratory fitness, their VO2 peak. But the response in insulin sensitivity is highly variable. So there are a lot of participants that can improve their insulin sensitivity, but there are other participants that are not able to do that, at least not in this particular exercise intervention study. And now with this different response, we are now able to go for the underlying mechanisms and to see which are here the positive and which are the negative regulators. And we have two groups. We have a group of responders and a group of non-responders. And very importantly, the adherence to training is the same. This is here shown as energy expenditure. There is no difference in the energy expenditure in the group of responders in insulin sensitivity and the group of non-responders. And now with this group of responders and non-responders, we can go and identify the underlying mechanisms and the positive regulators. And here what we did is we performed a transcriptome analysis of the skeletal muscle of these participants before and after the training period. And we had a look which transcripts are regulated and which transcripts are regulated in the participants which have an improved insulin sensitivity. And you can see here 3 examples. First of all, the increase in the glucose transporter 4 expression is positively correlated with an improvement in insulin sensitivity. This of course makes sense because improvement in glucose uptake into skeletal muscle tissue, of course, is quite important to improve insulin sensitivity. Then this here is an enzyme of fatty acid oxidation. And the increase in this enzyme is also positively correlated with an increase in the insulin sensitivity. And of course, fatty acid oxidation is very important for an increase in insulin sensitivity. And there's also a positive correlation between the increase in insulin sensitivity and an increased expression in VEGF, so the vascular endothelial growth factor. And clearly, the capillarization of the skeletal muscle, so for the delivery of the substrates of glucose and fatty acids to the muscle, is very important. And there are many more genes that are differentially regulated in the muscle of these two groups. And you can see here more genes related to glucose catabolism that are differentially regulated, amino acid metabolism, fatty acid catabolism. And here, many genes that are important for the oxidative phosphorylation, so the oxidation of all these substrates. And now, of course, the next question was, is there really an improvement in the mitochondrial oxidation in the muscle after training? And does this has anything to do with an improvement in insulin sensitivity? And we can measure this mitochondrial oxidation, and you can see here how we are doing that. So here you can see kind of a muscle biopsy tissue, and then we dissect this tissue into single fibers, and then we put the fibers in an instrument called oxygraph, and then we can add different substrates for all these different complexes in the respiratory chain and measure the oxidation of these substrates, and this is the overall mitochondrial capacity of oxidation of substrates. And here you can see the results. There's clearly with training an increase in the oxidation of mitochondrial substrates. So there is an increase in the TCA cycle dependent oxidation, an increase in the maximal coupled oxidation, and an increase in the maximal uncoupled oxidation. Now, training clearly has a positive effect on mitochondrial oxidation. But is this related to the improvement in insulin sensitivity? The answer is yes. However, as you can see, this is a weak correlation. It's important, but quite clearly, there are other mechanisms that are involved in the improvement in insulin sensitivity with training. Okay, but now to the people who are not able to respond with an improvement in insulin sensitivity in our study. What about the non-responders? Can we get an idea of what is going on in the muscle of the non-responders? And for this, we have again a look on the transcriptional profile. And these are all regulators that are apparently, based on the transcriptome analysis, activated in the muscle of the non-responders. And you can see here several regulators that are involved in inflammation. And one of these is the cytokine TGF-beta. And what you can see here is that the increase in TGF-beta target gene, so genes upregulated by enhanced activity of TGF-beta, is negatively correlated with the fold change in insulin sensitivity. So the higher the increase in the TGF-beta target gene, the lower is the improvement of insulin sensitivity. So apparently, TGF-beta activation in muscle is not good for an improvement in insulin sensitivity. But of course, the first question is, what is TGF-beta doing in skeletal muscle? And this you can see here. TGF-beta plays an important role during tissue inflammation in skeletal muscle. So if you have small tissue injuries, then you have the release of MCP1, for example, from already present immune cells. You have the recruitment of macrophages, which then releases other cytokines. And then also TGF-beta is released, not only for macrophages, it can also be released, for example, from the myofibers themselves. And TGF-beta is very important to come back to tissue homeostasis and to resolve this kind of inflammation. And with, for example, prolonged endurance exercise or resistance training, there is TGF-beta activation in the muscle. And it's quite probable that if you are untrained and if you start doing exercise, that then you will also have kind of small tissue injuries, and this is an activation of TGF-beta. And apparently in some participants, it was the case that there was a chronic TGF-beta activation. And now the next question was this really the cause for the impaired response in insulin sensitivity? And we studied this. We studied this in human skeletal muscle cells. And we really could see that TGF-beta reduces insulin signaling, that TGF-beta reduces the expression of several important regulators of mitochondrial function, mitochondrial biogenesis, and other enzymes important for substrate oxidation. Here, for example, PGC1-alpha and TFAM, those are transcription factors or transcriptional co-regulators. And TGF-beta can block the fusion of the muscle stem cells, of satellite cells, with already existing myofibers. So TGF-beta can really have negative effects, and with that, we think that TGF-beta can contribute to an impaired response in insulin sensitivity. And very important, this is a local event, because in the plasma of these subjects, there was no difference in TGF-beta. Now, with this, this is my first summary. So, of course, there are many tissues that can be or that are responding to exercise, but of course, the muscle is the most important one. And what is clearly, or what are clearly positive regulators, very important to improve insulin sensitivity, is an increase in mitochondrial substrate oxidation, is an increase in glucose transport, is an increase in capillarization of muscle tissue, and apparently a prolonged activation of TGF-beta can be a negative regulator. So now, what should we do? What can we do with these people who are not able to respond? Now, exercise physiologists always claim more is better. And this is based on the studies like this study here by Carsten Lundby. What they showed here is that with only one training session per week or two training sessions per week, not all people are able to improve their cardiorespiratory fitness, their VO2 max. However, when the people increase their training sessions, so here they have three, or here they have five, and here they have already three at the beginning, all are able to improve their cardiorespiratory fitness. Now, would this be a good recommendation for people who are untrained, who have a low training status? We think no, because as you can see, this can lead to an activation of TGF-beta, and this can then impair your response in insulin sensitivity. And therefore, we think it's really much better to start low and to go slow if you are starting doing exercise to have a benefit in your metabolic control. Now, the muscle is, of course, an important tissue with regard to exercise adaptations. However, all the other tissues can also respond to exercise, and their adaptations can also be important for improvement of insulin sensitivity, glucose tolerance, and, of course, to prevent type 2 diabetes. Now, yesterday, in the lecture of Martin Heaney, we already heard about the important role of the brain in metabolic control, and that the brain is also an insulin-sensitive tissue, an insulin target organ. And therefore, Martin asked the question, what is exercise doing with the brain? Do we see changes in brain function after this 8 weeks of exercise intervention? And Stephanie Kuhlmann can measure this. She can measure the cerebral blood flow. And what you can see here is the cerebral blood flow in the cerebellum before this 8 weeks of training and after the 8 weeks of training. And you can see there is a clear increase in the basal blood flow in this brain region. And she can also show that there is also an increase not only in the cerebellum, also in the midbrain in blood flow, basal blood flow. And both regions are very important in regulating movement and coordination. So I think this is really fascinating. After only 8 weeks of training, this clear increase in, yeah, in the blood flow in these areas in the brain, which then of course makes it quite probable that that can lead in the long term to a maintenance of your motor function. Okay, you have also heard yesterday that with an intranasal application of insulin, it's possible to measure the response to insulin in certain brain regions. And here you can see the response in a region called the striatum, which is also important for movement, but also for learning. And before exercise, there is only a negative response, so no increase in the blood flow after insulin application. And this is quite typical for obese subjects. And of course, most of the participants of our study are obese, so a quite typical response. And after 8 weeks of training, you can see how then they respond to insulin with an increased blood flow. So this is now quite similar to the response in this brain region of lean people. So after only 8 weeks of training, you can say that the response to insulin in this specific brain region is normalized. And now, as I said, this region is related to movement and learning. But what about the peripheral metabolic control, peripheral insulin sensitivity, or other parameters? Is there a correlation? And this correlation you can see here. So this is normalized insulin response in this region. There is a clear correlation to the decrease in visceral fat. And you have seen in the beginning of my talk how important is the visceral fat for insulin resistance or prevention of insulin resistance. So there is clearly a correlation to peripheral metabolic parameters. Now, to summarize this part, this 8 weeks of aerobic training increases the cerebral blood flow in brain areas responsible for motor control and coordination, and it can also increase the brain response to insulin in specific regions. And this normalization of brain response to insulin correlates with an improvement of peripheral metabolic parameters. Now, the question is, what is here the connection? How is a muscle connected to the brain? Is there a connection? Maybe you have heard about myokines. Myokines are proteins that are produced in the muscle upon exercise, and then they are released and can act on other organs and tissues in our body. And in mouse studies, it was shown that there are two myokines, irisin and cathepsin B, that are produced in the muscle. This is also true for humans. And then in mouse studies, they showed that these two myokines can act on the brain and improve cognitive function. And of course, this will now be our next question. What is with these myokines in our human exercise intervention studies? And of course, the other important question is, how does the brain then influence the peripheral metabolism and metabolic control? Now, with my last slide, I will talk about whether type 2 diabetes itself is a risk factor for a reduced benefit from exercise. And there are some studies that already give some hints in this direction. So for example, studies showed that there is a slower rate of oxygen uptake adjustment in the muscle with exercise in type 2 diabetes patients, and that they have in general a lower exercise tolerance. However, you have to consider that on average, the type 2 diabetes patient has a lower VO2 peak compared to obese people and compared, of course, to lean people. And of course, the VO2 peak influences the exercise tolerance. And therefore, we ask the question, if we matched normal healthy control people and type 2 diabetes people so that they have a similar VO2 peak, is it then their metabolic response to exercise really different? And we did this study together with our colleagues in Copenhagen with Peter and Jakob. And you can see here the age of our group and also that they are matched for VO2 max and for their BMI. And what we did, they performed one bout of exercise at 50% of their VO2 max. And we took serial blood samples and also muscle biopsies and asked the question, is the metabolic response to exercise different in these two groups. And with the blood samples, we performed metabolomics analysis. And we measured, for example, acylcarnitines. And acylcarnitines are marker for the ongoing glucose and fatty acid and amino acid oxidation. In particular, the ratio here, the ratio of the acylcarnitine C2 and C3 to the free carnitine is a very good marker for ongoing substrate oxidation. And you can see here the response of normal healthy controls to this bout of exercise. There is a continuous increase in this ratio, and this, it remains higher also in the recovery phase. And now here, the type 2 diabetic patients, exactly the same reaction, the same response to exercise. So apparently, they have no deficit in switching their oxidation substrates to, in this case, glucose and fatty acid mainly. Okay, and we also measured the glucose rate of appearance and disappearance. Here again, you can see the normal healthy controls. You can see the strong increase of exercise because, of course, there is an increase in the glucose delivery to the skeletal muscle. And here you can see the glucose rate of appearance and disappearance in the type 2 diabetes patients. Before exercise, it's higher because they have a higher glucose output from the liver. But with this bout of exercise, there is kind of a normalization. There is no difference anymore between the normal glucose tolerant people and the type 2 diabetes group. Of course, this is transient, but I think we can clearly say when matched for VO2 max, the metabolic flexibility during exercise is preserved. And what I did not show you, we also have indications of a pronounced transcriptional adaptation in the muscle of the type 2 diabetes patient, so maybe an even better response. And studies of the group of Jörn Wojtaszewski showed that the contraction-induced muscle glucose uptake is not different between type 2 diabetes patients and controls. The AMPK activation is not different. Also, the PGC1-alpha expression is preserved in type 2 diabetes. So I think these are quite promising data. And with this, I would like to close. And I hope I could show you that a focus on exercise metabolism is not only good for prevention of type 2 diabetes, it's also good for your brain and your health span. And I think it also makes quite a lot of fun doing exercise. And of course, with the last slide, I would like to thank the people who did the work. So in our institute, mainly Christoph Hoffmann, Lisa Kaple, and Miriam Höhne are involved in this exercise intervention studies. And in our Institute for Diabetes Research, I would like to thank Anja, Stephanie, Hubert, Luisa is also important here, then Martin Heaney for the brain studies, Andreas Fritsche, and of course, Hans Hering. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you so much, Cora, for this excellent presentation, for this journey into the muscle and the brain, and also for making all these complex, complicated things simple to us, to our audience. Are there any questions, comments? Kiram Dragu.
Thank you very much. Very elegant presentation.
Thank you very much.
Very elegant studies for a very nice proof. I was wondering, the people with diabetes that you studied at the end, have they reached normal glucose levels? So you saw that the rate of appearance, disappearance was normal, or they were
No, high? So the glucose levels remained higher. It was really only the glucose rate of appearance and disappearance.
So how normalized. Could it be that they were both normal then? Appearance and disappearance.
Yeah, so of course this is regulated by you know, of course by the delivery and the uptake. So, but of course when we measured the level, the overall level, can be still higher. And this was only one bout of exercise, so we did not train them, so we cannot say, you know, in long term whether.
Yeah, I would expect that the blood glucose became normal. That's why you had those results.
Yeah, but you know, it could be regulated on a higher level with an equal rate of appearance and disappearance.
Άλλες ερωτήσεις, παρακαλώ. Σχόλια. Ωραία, ας προχωρήσουμε γιατί δεν μας παίρνει και η ώρα, είμαστε λίγο πίσω στο πρόγραμμα.